So today we're going to be talking about chapter 29, and that's challenges of nation building in Africa and the Middle East. And we're going to be discussing a lot of modern concerns with both regions of the world, things that are going on today with crises in Syria and many parts of the Middle East and Africa as well. So this picture is a photograph of Muslims at prayer, and this is called the Call of the Muezzin. And this is one of the five pillars of faith in Islam. All faithful Muslims are required five times daily to face Mecca and to pray. They can go to a mosque and do this. First, let's begin by talking about Africa. And I'd like to look at the colonial legacy. We'll begin by looking at the limited modernization that Africa has experienced in the post-colonial world. Similar to Asia, colonial rule had a very mixed impact on the societies and peoples of Africa. The Western presence generally brought some short and long-term benefits. One long-term being the development of infrastructure, be it roads, buildings, transportation, into a more modern economy and more modern country in general. This resulted in improved sanitation, increased life expectancy. But while these benefits are amazing, and we can't attribute them to Western imperialism, the trouble with these, and really the trouble with the modern world, is that these benefits are distributed unequally. The vast majority of African people saw little significant improvement in their lives. In fact, most Africans throughout the 20th century and even continuing into today were subsistence farmers, meaning growing enough to survive. There are only a couple countries where there is an exception. For example, South Africa or Algeria, held by the French, developed entire modern industrial sectors. However, in both countries, while Europeans are numerous, for example, if you go to South Africa, you're as likely to meet a white person as a black, dark-skinned person. So while settlers were numerous, most of the financial investment was focused on these European settlers and did not significantly improve the lives of the native African people. For example, most indigenous populations in Africa, and I'm generalizing because we're talking about the largest landmass on the planet, but most indigenous people were restricted to either unskilled jobs or semi-skilled jobs, and typically were paid one-fifth of what your average European settler could expect to make. And so this caused a degree of discontent, really a rise of nationalism, not unlike what we've experienced here in the West. For example, on the Gold Coast, many political organizations did not truly begin to arise until after the First World War. And one reason for this was many of these African colonies found themselves conscripted to fight in the wars in Europe. And this caused a great deal of discontent among the colonial peoples, and so it began this nationalist movement. And then finally, after the Second World War, as there were many independence movements going on elsewhere, many groups on the Gold Coast began to form independent political parties. For example, in the late 1940s in Kenya, the National African Union was formed. And though it was meant to focus on economic issues, it had a specific political agenda. Another famous movement is the Mau Mau movement. And though these activities were mainly nonviolent, they were in fact led by many Western educated elites. So not unlike the South American. Next, let's talk about the rise of nationalism in South Africa. And we'll begin with the African National Congress. In South Africa and Algeria, the political system was really dominated by European settlers. And so the transition to independence as a result of this is going to be complicated. Think of apartheid. For example, in South Africa, political activity by indigenous peoples began with the African National Congress, whose goal was to achieve economic and political reforms, but again was dominated by Western-oriented elites and had limited grassroots support. However, their goals were quite admirable. Full equality for all South African citizens. That is, all educated African citizens. But back to apartheid. The African National Congress's efforts were largely unsuccessful. Whites still dominated politics in South Africa. There were laws imposing segregation. These laws were called apartheid. That is, a policy of full legal segregation imposed in 1948. And as a result of these discriminatory policies, the once peaceful African National Congress became increasingly violent. The next example is French North Africa. In Algeria, French rule was rather contentious. In fact, the Berbers and the Arab people living in Algeria had been resisting French rule for the duration of their presence there. And again, after the Second World War, this resistance intensified. In fact, it became an all-out rebellion by the mid-1950s. The French government tried to continue to maintain its authority, not unlike what they had done in Vietnam. However, in 1958, when Charles de Gaulle became president, he decided that it was time for Algeria to have their independence. And this struggle in Algeria had a domino effect. In fact, many neighboring states began to seek independence as well, such as Tunisia and Morocco. And again, the French were unsuccessful in maintaining their dominance over these regions. The Gold Coast was renamed to Ghana in 1957. And soon after, Nigeria and Congo, renamed Zaire, Kenya, and all of these places became independent states and no longer colonies of European countries. In fact, by the late 1960s, there were only a few portions of the And so here we're looking at a map of modern Africa. In fact, this map shows Africa as a large, diverse collection of independent states, and this is the condition. And now let's begin to talk about Africa's destiny. And that is in the era of independence. Now that Africa is largely independent from Europe, what does this mean? Should they adopt a Western-style capitalism and pattern their forms of government and economic commerce on the Europeans? Or should they develop a more leftist approach, such as what we've seen in Latin and South America? And so these are tangible, intimidating challenges. You see, colonialism had introduced Western styles of government and technology and values, such as the Protestant work ethic. Those were inherent in African culture. Just because the European political dominance had left, the culture remained. And though these had been introduced, and though technology had been introduced, the majority of African people lived a rural and agrarian, very traditional way of life. And so again, the question, Western-style capitalism or a uniquely African brand of socialism? So most leaders, not unlike the general theme we've seen so far, most West African independent political leaders were coming from the urban middle or even upper class. Most had studied in Europe or the United States. Most spoke English. Most understood democracy. And though these same people had been profoundly critical of colonial policies, they mainly accepted the Western model. And at the very least, verbally accepted the idea of democracy. However, economics is where we find many differences. Some, like General Mobutu and Zaire, were advocates of capitalism. Others, like the leaders of Ghana or Guinea or Tanzania, preferred a, quote, African form of socialism, which was really not unlike what Marx and Lenin had practiced in the early Soviet Union. Now, Africa as a continent is extremely diverse. It's very large, so it's hard to generalize. So I can just give you many examples, as many as we have time. And at first, most of these new African leaders generally accepted the national boundaries that had been established by European states. But you see, these boundaries are not logical. They're not drawn along ethnic, historical, culturally separated barriers, such as mountains or rivers, or what would have historically separated groups of people, allowing them to develop uniquely historic cultures and languages and ethnicities. No, that's too logical. You see, during the colonial times, boundaries had been drawn based on spheres of influence, based on power, based on where can these European countries gain the resources they desire, and how much territory can they acquire and maintain. And now that we're in the post-colonial world, we're still dealing with those same boundaries that weren't drawn on any logical basis. And what are we left with? We're left with countries that don't make sense. Virtually all the new states include widely diverse ethnic, linguistic, and territorial groups. And if you speak to anyone who is knowledgeable on what makes a nation, that's not it. When a group of people choose to form together, it's not typically a group of people speaking different languages. That causes a cultural barrier and tends to lead to separation. The same with ethnic differences. The same with topographical differences. I mean, it doesn't make sense to have a group of people living at 10,000 feet in the Andes connected politically with a group of people living on the beach. They just have little in common. And so they would probably not choose to be tied together politically. But again, this is the reality of the situation in Africa. For example, Zaire has more than 200 territorial groups speaking 75 different languages. Now, I know we have some xenophobic people in this country. And I know we have some people who hold this English-only sentiment and who look down on others who speak English as a second language. And sure, that is a sentiment shared by some, not by myself. But I can't imagine how confusing it would be to live in a country where 75 different languages are commonly spoken. And so this proposes a significant and severe challenge to forming a cohesive state. How do you unify a group of people that cannot speak to one another? However, there was an important movement going on in the post-colonial world, and that was called Pan-Africanism. Pan-Africanism is the concept of continental unity, a unity that should transcend national boundaries. It's a wonderful idea in theory. The hope was that this concept would unite all of these new countries into a broader community. And so this organization formed called the Organization of African Unity, founded in 1963. The goal, while controversial, led to the Organization of African Unity. And while Africa has never truly and fully unified, there are those who wish. Next, let's talk about the political and economic conditions in contemporary Africa. Now, the Organization for African Unity called for a new culture throughout the continent, a culture based on equality and justice and dignity, with the idea of solidarity, and that this unity would lead to prosperity for all. It's a beautiful theory. It's a wonderful idea. It's like listening to John Lennon's song Imagine, and don't you just wish it could be like that? But that's not reality, unfortunately. It's a nice idea. You see, Africa is so diverse. Over 200 spoken languages throughout the continent. It's very diverse in both socioeconomic status, educational attainment, culture, language, religion, you name it. And so this makes it difficult to establish a real significant impact in material prosperity throughout much of Africa. The expectation, though, was that independence would create stability and would lead to democracy. But in fact, this wonderful idea of revolution and independence transitioned by democracy led to the development of military regimes and, in many cases, totalitarian states. In fact, between 1957 and 1982 alone, more than 70 leaders of African countries were either violently murdered, deposed, or imprisoned in violent revolutions. And so, Africa has found itself in a new period, and this is called neo-colonialism. Neo-colonialism. And it's textbook developing country. When the United States was a young country, we exported raw materials, and we imported finished products. And we were always at an economic disadvantage as long as that remained true. And part of that was just the lingering holds of colonialism, that Britain was the mother country, and the finished products were made there. And we exported the raw materials. Well, you see, most new countries in Africa only had one significant and only still have one significant export or natural resource. It is either a crop, an iron, a metal, a diamond, etc. And so the trouble with a single export nation is they're not diversified. What happens if the price of coal drops suddenly? Well, the entire nation's economy is in shambles. It's kind of like when you have a factory town and the factory leaves and the town shuts down. Now imagine that on a national scale. In several cases, these resources were still controlled by foreigners. Yay, political revolution! But in reality, these European business people still held the means of production. And so colonialism, while in theory had been overthrown, you could make the argument that it was merely succeeded by neocolonialism. And that is that Western domination was maintained primarily by economic rather than political or military means. So as I said, African states wind up importing technology and manufactured finished goods, and the prices of those things are much greater than raw materials. And many of these states were causing their own problems as well. We can't just blame all this on Europe. Many of these scarce national resources were squandered on military equipment needed to fight these constant wars, or on consumer goods rather than allocated rationally. And a painful reality in Africa is that many of these states became extremely corrupt. And so bribery has become a way of life to receive even the most basic of services. Recently watched a documentary of some brave kayak explorers who navigated the Congo River, the Grand Inga Rapids. They were the first to do so and survive. It's kind of cool. Others had tried, they had all died, and this group, and they documented their journey. It's on Netflix, by the way. Look up the Grand Inga Project, and you can watch their journey. To get to the river, I lost count of how many people they had to bribe. And they just pulled this off a year or two ago. And they were constantly bribing someone. And it's become a way of life in the Congo and throughout much of Africa. Many of these problems encountered occurred because independence did not actually bring an end to Western interference. Now, the United States was involved in overthrowing certain regimes in Africa because of the Truman Doctrine's commitment to stop the spread of communism. In fact, we even orchestrated an assassination of a pro-communist leader in the Congo. And so really, the organization, the OAU, was formed as a means of trying to reduce Western influence, but was largely unsuccessful. Most African leaders tried to stay out of the Cold War because the competition between Moscow and Washington was so fierce. However, African states were never able to truly agree on much of anything. Border disputes were common. In the cases of Kenya and Uganda, at times flared into full-scale war. And now, to make matters worse, there are high levels of poverty among individual Africans, an epidemic of the AIDS virus, combined with a rapidly growing population. In fact, throughout the 1980s, annual population growth was the highest rate of any continent on the planet. Couple that with severe drought conditions, the spread of the Sahara Desert, and you have widespread hunger, true starvation on a large scale, and the terrible, desperate conditions that we've seen in Somalia and Nigeria and Mali in Sudan, in Ethiopia. In fact, many of those places you've heard so much about, you hear Ethiopia, an image of starving children comes to mind. Somalia, the same thing. Many believe that Africa's population will increase by over 200 million more over the next 10 years alone. However, some say that doesn't take into account the devastation which will be caused by the AIDS virus, which has again reached epidemic proportions. At least 5% of all Africans living south of the Sahara Desert are infected. More than 65% of all AIDS cases around the world are from the continent of Africa. Some say this will reduce population growth, but the reality is that poverty is still so widespread throughout Africa. And around three-quarters, 75% of their population is still in subsistence agriculture today, meaning have. So, how do we fix this problem? Really, how does anybody fix this problem? How does Africa fix this for themselves? How does Europe help them fix it? The search for solutions. And each state has had to deal with these challenges in their own way. Some African countries have shown great improvement over the past 20 years. However, it's impossible to generalize because this is one of the most diverse areas on the planet. But I want to give you a few examples. Tanzania, we'll begin with. Now, out of concern for economic inequality, a number of African leaders decided to restrict or discourage foreign investment and to nationalize or host government takeovers of the major industries. This was a move towards socialism. And the idea was he hoped this movement would spread throughout the continent. The man's name was Julius Nyerere. This resulted in the Arusha Declaration of 1967. And the goal was not to establish any type of Soviet system or Leninist-style dictatorship. His hope was actually some form of democratic socialism. And I'd like to quote him briefly. He says, "Where there is one party, provided it is identified with the nation as a whole, the foundations of democracy can be firmer, and the people can have more opportunity to exercise a real choice than when you have two or more parties." He hoped to bring in the British parliamentary system and gained a great deal of political influence. In fact, some of his policies were quite severe, such as placing a cap on the amount of income you could make. He established collectives within villages, which is a pretty extreme form of socialism. That is where the villages produce the goods and then distribute them equally among the people of that village. And many countries were very interested in what Tanzania was up to. It was fascinating. If he could pull off this extreme transition and set up a democratic socialist state, it would be one of the few. And so many countries provided significant economic aid. However, many people observed that though this system sounds neat in theory, in practice, there were high levels of corruption, the government was generally unstable, and Tanzania, as I said before, has 70 different spoken languages, 200 different ethnic groups. And so while his vision was interesting, it was not shared by all. And the state began to dismantle. Several reasons for this. One is that Tanzania has very poor soil. They are not a naturally rich country. They have very limited rainfall. They have very limited natural resources. You see, what assisted the United States during our Industrial Revolution? We have a wealth of natural resources. The eastern United States, at least, has abundant rainfall where most of the population were living. We have a large population of, at that time, generally homogeneous, same language-ish, and making for at least a cheap workforce. Tanzania had none of those things. And so in 1985, Julius Nyerere stepped down. In his farewell speech, he confessed to his failure. However, he argued the only real solution was to consolidate whole nations, small countries, into a federation. And while he failed in his vision, his revolutionary party is still the ruling party in Tanzania. Now, I want to discuss Kenya and the perils of capitalism. We'll begin with the income disparities. You see, we could be quick to criticize what Tanzania tried and say, well, that was socialism. Government is inherently corrupt. It's going to fall apart. It's going to, caps on income are going to cause all these problems. And we could just criticize the system. But as I hope I've demonstrated, the complexities within Tanzania, the poor soil, the poor natural resources, the increasingly diverse population, has made it difficult to modernize. But now let's look at a capitalist experiment in Kenya. Now, Kenya has better soil, especially in the mountainous regions. They have had traditionally aggressive commerce, meaning they've been engaging in some form of capitalism prior to the post-colonial world, prior to European encroachment. And Kenya has a strong culture of African capitalism. They have a substantial middle class. Most of these live around the city of Nairobi. But then we have to look at the other side. The levels of poverty and unemployment and landlessness are high even by African standards. Their population growth is one of the highest in the planet. And despite a strong middle class, almost 80% of the population are rural, and half of the population lives below the poverty line. Now, like Tanzania, Kenya has had chronic disputes among disparate ethnic groups. And for many years, the country has maintained a fragile level of stability. And let's be real, it was under the rule of a dictator. President Daniel Arap Mio. He finally agreed to retire in 2002 because of corruption. But his successor has continued to perpetuate this political instability, this widespread poverty. And the point is that Kenya's not doing so well either. Let's go back to South Africa and apartheid. Because really, South Africa might be one of the brightest spots in the story of Africa. The generally white-dominated government in South Africa, which had been there since the time of British rule, had maintained this policy of segregation called apartheid, and restricted black sovereignty to a few poor areas of the country. But through a peaceful movement, they were forced to finally accept the inevitability of African involvement in the political process. And perhaps one of the most significant moments in this movement was when Nelson Mandela was released from prison in 1990. He had been held there for 26 years as a political prisoner. And when he was released, people paraded in the streets, followed him wherever he went, threatened revolution if he were not allowed an opportunity to run for president. And so in 1993, Mandela and the current president, Frederick de Klerk, met and agreed to a peaceful, democratic election. And Nelson Mandela won in a landslide. In May of 1996, he called for a new constitution. He called for a multiracial state. And this was a major step towards political stability. And even more impressive, in 1999, after he had served his terms, he stepped down. And he allowed a successor to replace him through a democratic process. And that's a difficult hurdle for many new nations to achieve. We had a similar what-if moment during the election of 1800 as a brand new nation. Read the story for yourself sometime. It's amazing. Now, South Africa remains the wealthiest and most industrialized state in Africa, and they are truly the best hope that we have for a multiracial society to succeed on the African continent. In fact, at this time, compared to 1991, the country's black elite, that is, indigenous Africans involved in the political process with the means to influence, are now one quarter of its wealthiest households, compared with only 9%. The next example I want to give you is in Nigeria. Nigeria has been a nation divided since the end of colonialism. And since 1998, Nigeria has been left to civilian rule. And while South Africa is an encouraging story, it makes for a good movie. There have been several good movies about South Africa because it's a hopeful story. You don't see as many movies about Nigeria because its current situation is rather concerning. In regards to population, it's the largest country and has the wealthiest oil reserves. However, for many years, Nigeria was ruled by the military. And under this military rule, generals suppressed all opposition. And throughout the late 90s, ordered the execution of protesters. In fact, one very public execution of a writer, despite widespread global protest. What had this writer done? His name was Ken Saro Wiwa. He had simply criticized environmental damage caused by foreign companies in Nigeria. And his death led to the call for a civil government. However, civilian non-military leadership didn't fix all of Nigeria's problems. Although reforms were promised, the results have been largely disappointing. Presidential elections were held in 07. And many complained the vote was rigged. And after the winner of that election died, he was succeeded by his vice president named Goodluck Jonathan, who was elected on his own in 2011. But like many parts of the world, Nigeria has been plagued with religious conflicts. In fact, one of the most critical problems facing the Nigerian government is religious disputes. In the early 2000s, riots often broke out between Christians and Muslims. And these religious tensions continue to threaten the unity of Africa's most populated country. So let's continue our discussion with South Sudan. The religious tensions that erupted in Nigeria spilled over into neighboring states. One of these, the state of Mali, a historic Islamic country, following these troubles in Nigeria, attempted to impose Sharia law or Islamic law. Lengthy civil wars have raged throughout the Sudan. Conflicts between Muslim herders and Christian farmers have gone on for decades. In fact, this dispute between Muslims and Christians throughout southern Sahara is part of traditional tensions that have existed between farmers and herders in this part of the world throughout recorded history. So one could make the argument that this is not simply a theological dispute between religions, but part of a broader, long-standing conflict of herders trampling on farmers' land. And now let's look at Rwanda and Burundi, the famous conflict between the Hutus and the Tutsis. And this is perhaps the most tragic situation. In the Central African states of Rwanda and Burundi, this conflict between the Tutsis and the Hutu has led to a bitter civil war. And this has resulted in thousands of refugees fleeing to neighboring countries. The Tutsis were generally nomadic, and they had been supported by the colonial Belgian government. And they had dominated Rwandan politics. And when Belgian colonialism had come to an end, the Hutus went to war against the Tutsis. And this conflict has been marked by massacres on both sides. sure you've heard of the Rwandan genocides. Now, in the meantime, large numbers of foreign troops and refugees intensified these forces. In fact, during 1997's civil war, General Mobutu's longtime opponent crippled and toppled the general's government. Once in power, promised a return to democracy, though this new government systematically suppressed dissent. And in 2001, the leader was assassinated. Succeeded by his son, the fighting continued. And as recent as 2011, this part of the world is still in conflict. Now, what I've given you is just a survey of events in some of the more important African countries. And what I've attempted to do was to illustrate the enormous difficulty that we have in trying to draw any general conclusions about the type of change we can expect to see in our lifetimes. The point is that each one of these stories are rather unique, and each one of them are extremely complex, more so than I can tell you in an hour. And progress in some of these areas has been countered by growing problems elsewhere. It seems as soon as we feel hope about one part of Africa, we have to look at the Rwandan genocides or the civil wars in the Congo, and again feel despair. Now, over the past two decades, we've seen the collapse of one-party regimes, and we've seen the emergence of democracies. However, in many of the cases, such as the one we just discussed, these very same democratic governments erupted into civil war and were replaced by authoritarian leaders. Yet again, points out how lucky we were as a nation that we've not had to deal with these things. There are some positives we can look at, such as the Ivory Coast, considered one of Africa's most stable and prosperous countries. And on the Ivory Coast, national elections were held in 2010. But sadly, even these, in this most stable and prosperous of countries, led to sporadic violence. And the sitting president had to be forced to resign. In Libya, a bitter civil war recently gave way to the emergence of a democratic government. We have seen increased economic growth in some parts of Africa, though in reality this is mixed, because as I said, most residents of African states are poor. Most of their people are unable to read. And Africa is largely ignored by the international community. The World Trade Organization reached an agreement recently emphasizing the need to reduce agricultural subsidies in the advanced nations. Some people believe that this external assistance cannot succeed unless the nations of Africa bring about good government. I don't know if you've ever seen any clips a movies about Africa, but the movie Black Hawk Down comes to mind, of a conflict in Somalia. If you've not seen it, I recommend it. But there's a scene where the soldiers are handing out aid, food, and medicine to civilians. And as soon as the American soldiers leave, the corrupt military comes in and steals it from the people. And sadly, that's too common. So despite the entire continent's chronic economic problems, there are things we can hope for. For example, the overall rate of economic growth has improved greatly. African countries were actually less severely hurt by the recession than we were. And though AIDS and poverty and a lack of education and infrastructure are still major impediments, rising commodity prices have aided many of these countries. For example, many of these countries are rich in oil. And many of them, as a result, have been able to reduce their national debt. Next is this concept of the African Union, an African economic community, really. You see, a significant part of this problem is that Africans are going to have to find ways to cooperate with one another to protect their own interests. And a big step was taken in this direction in 1991 with the African Economic Community, which was later in 2001 replaced by the African Union. And the intention here was to provide greater political and economic integration throughout the continent based on the European Union. So we're not talking about the formation of a continent-sized state, but what we're talking about is an agreement to economic cooperation. And so this new organization, much like the EU, has sought to mediate conflicts in the region. But we have to understand this will be a slow process. We will see slow progress throughout our lifetimes. And we have to consider that Africa's industrial revolution has occurred within the past century. Africa's introduction to democracy has been rather recent. And African societies generally are still groping for ways to integrate Western political institutions and Western economic practices onto a culture still significantly influenced by traditional values and attitudes. How do you change a culture? How do you modernize a people? That's a question too big for me.
New housing for the poor. Under apartheid, much of the black population in South Africa was confined to so-called townships, squalid slums located along the fringes of the country's major cities. The top photo shows a crowded township on the edge of Cape Town, one of the most modern cities on the continent of Africa. Today, the government is actively building new communities that provide better housing, running water, and electricity for their residents. The photo on the bottom shows a new township on the outskirts of the city of New London. The township has many modern facilities and even a new shopping mall with consumer goods for local residents. Mourning in Timbuktu. The boundary between pastoral and agricultural peoples, the steppe and the zone, has been one of the crucial fault lines in human history. Nowhere is this more true today than in West Africa, where Muslim herders compete with Christian farmers for precious land and water resources. The dispute is at the root of the ethnic and religious conflicts that are now erupting throughout the region. In this photo, a pastoral family greets the new day just outside the historic city of Timbuktu, in the state of Mali. Once an important commercial hub on the trans-Saharan trade routes, Timbuktu today is a sleepy river port on the edge of the vast Sahara. Carrying food to the temple. Bali is the only island in Indonesia where the local population adheres to the Hindu faith. Here worshippers carry food to the local temple to be blessed before being consumed. 3. Continuity and change in modern African societies. In general, the impact of the West has been greater on urban and educated Africans and more limited on their rural and illiterate compatriots. After all, the colonial presence was first and most firmly established in the cities. Many cities, including Dakar, Lagos, Johannesburg, Cape Town, Brazzaville, and Nairobi, and direct products of the colonial experience. Most African cities today look like their counterparts elsewhere in the world. They have high-rise buildings, blocks of residential apartments, wide boulevards, neon lights, movie theaters, and traffic jams. Education. Continued high levels of illiteracy. Europeans introduced modern Western education into Africa in the 19th century. At first, the schools concentrated on vocational training, with some instruction in European languages and Western civilization. Eventually, pressure from Africans led to the introduction of professional training, and the first institutes of higher learning were established in the early 20th century. With independence, African countries established their own state-run schools. The emphasis was on the primary level, but high schools and universities were established in major cities. The basic objectives have been to introduce vocational training and improve literacy rates. Unfortunately, both funding and trained teachers are scarce in most countries, and few rural areas have schools. As a result, illiteracy remains high, estimated at about 70% of the population across the continent. There has been a perceptible shift toward education in the vernacular languages. In West Africa, only about 1 in 4 adults is conversant in a Western language. Urban and rural life. Western-influenced cities. The cities are where the African elites live and work. Affluent Africans, like their contemporaries in other developing countries, have been strongly attracted to the glittering material aspects of Western culture. They live in Western-style homes or apartments and eat Western foods stored in Western refrigerators, and those who can afford it drive Western cars. It has been said, not wholly in praise, that there are more Mercedes-Benz automobiles in Nigeria than in Germany, where they are manufactured. Massive rural migrations. Outside the major cities, where about three-quarters of the continent's inhabitants live, Western influence has had less impact. Millions of people throughout Africa live much as their ancestors did, in thatch huts without modern plumbing and electricity. They far more hunt by traditional methods, practice time-honored family rituals, and believe in the traditional deities. Even here, however, change is taking place. Slavery has been eliminated, for the most part, although there have been persistent reports of raids by slave traders on defenseless villages in the southern Sudan. Economic need, though, has brought about massive migrations as some leave to work on plantations, others move to the cities, and still others flee abroad or to refugee camps to escape starvation. Migration itself is a wrenching experience, disrupting familiar family and village ties and enforcing new social relationships. African women. Urban women, more equality. One of the consequences of colonialism in Africa was a change in the relationship between men and women. Some of these changes could be described as beneficial, but others were not. Women were often introduced to Western education and given legal rights denied to them in the pre-colonial era. But they also became a labor source and were sometimes recruited or compelled to work on construction projects. Independence has had a significant impact on gender roles in African society. Almost without exception, the new governments established the principle of sexual equality and permitted women to vote and run for political office. Yet as elsewhere, women continue to operate at a disadvantage in a world dominated by males. Politics remains a male preserve, and although a few professions, such as teaching, childcare, and clerical work, are dominated by women, Most African women are employed in menial positions such as agricultural labor, factory work, and retail trade or as domestics. Education is open to all at the elementary level, but women comprise less than 20% of students at the upper levels in most African societies today. Not surprisingly, women have made the greatest strides in the cities. Most urban women, like men, now marry on the basis of personal choice, although a significant minority are still willing to accept their parents' choice. After marriage, African women appear to occupy a more equal position than their counterparts in most Asian countries. Each marriage partner tends to maintain a separate income, and women often have the right to possess property separate from their husbands. While many wives still defer to their husbands in the traditional manner, others are like the woman in Abios Nicolas' story, a truly married woman comma who, after years of living as a common-law wife with her husband, is finally able to provide the price and finalize the marriage. After the wedding, she declares, "For 12 years I have got up every morning at 5 to make tea for you and breakfast. Now I am a truly married woman and you must treat me with a little more respect. You are now my husband and not a lover. Get up and make yourself a cup of tea." Women in rural areas. In rural areas, where traditional attitudes continue to exert a strong influence, individuals may still be subordinated to communalism. In some societies, female genital mutilation, the traditional rite of passage for a young girl as transit to womanhood, is still widely practiced. Polygamy is also not uncommon and arranged marriages are still the rule rather than the exception. The dichotomy between the rural and urban values can lead to acute tensions. Many African villagers regard the cities as the fount of evil, decadence, and corruption. Women in particular have suffered from the tension between the pull of the city and the village. As men are drawn to the cities in search of employment and excitement, their wives and girlfriends are left behind, both literally and figuratively, in the village. African culture. Inevitably, the tension between traditional and modern, indigenous and foreign, and individual and communal that has permeated contemporary African society has spilled over into culture. In general, in the visual arts and music, utility and ritual have given way to pleasure and decoration. In the process, Africans have been affected to a certain extent by foreign influences but have retained their distinctive characteristics. Wood carving, metalwork, painting, and sculpture, for example, have preserved their traditional forms but are now increasingly adapted to serve the tourist industry and the export market. Literature. Chinua Achebe, Things Fall Apart. Since independence, non-area of African culture has been so strongly affected by political and social events as literature. Angry at the negative portrayal of Africa in Western literature, African authors initially wrote primarily for a European audience as a means of establishing Black dignity and purpose. Many glorified the emotional and communal aspects of the traditional African experience. The Nigerian Chinua Achebe is considered the first major African novelist to write in the English language. In his writings, he attempted to interpret African history from an African perspective and to forge a new sense of African identity. In his trailblazing novel Things Fall Apart, he recounted the story of a Nigerian who refused to submit to the new British order and eventually committed suicide. Criticizing his contemporaries who accepted foreign rule, the protagonist lamented that the white man has put a knife on the things that held us together and we have fallen apart. In recent decades, the African novel has taken a dramatic turn, shifting its focus from the brutality of the foreign oppressor to the shortcomings of the continent's indigenous leaders. Having reaped the benefits of independence, African politicians are portrayed as mimicking and even outdoing the injustices committed by their colonial predecessors. A prominent example of this genre is the work of the Kenyan Gwathingas, Ogwatahangigo. His first novel, A Grain of Wheat, takes place on the eve of Uhuru, or independence. Although it mocks the racism, snobbishness, and superficiality of local British society, its chief interest lies in its unsentimental and even unflattering portrayal of ordinary Kenyans in their daily struggle for survival. Wool Soyinka, The Interpreters. Many Unguia's contemporaries have followed his lead and focused their frustration on the failure of the continent's new leadership to carry out the goals of independence. One of the most outstanding is the Nigerian Wole Soyinka. His novel The Interpreters lambasted the corruption and hypocrisy of Nigerian politics. Succeeding novels and plays have continued that tradition, resulting in a Nobel Prize for Literature in 1986. A number of Africa's most prominent writers today are women. Traditionally, African women were valued for their talents as storytellers, but writing was strongly discouraged by both traditional and colonial authorities on the grounds that women should occupy themselves with their domestic obligations. In recent years, however, a number of women have emerged as prominent writers of African fiction. One example is Amadou Aidoo of Ghana, who has focused on the identity of today's African women and the changing relations between men and women in society. In her novel Changes, a love story, she chronicles the lives of three women, none presented as a victim but all caught up in the struggle for survival and happiness. What is the future of Africa? Western materialism or African uniqueness? Nowhere in the developing world is the dilemma of continuity and change more agonizing than in Africa. Mesmerized by the spectacle of Western affluence yet repulsed by the bloody trail from slavery to World War II and the atomic bombs over Hiroshima and Nagasaki, African intellectuals have been torn between the dual images of Western materialism and African uniqueness. For the average African, of course, such intellectual dilemmas pale before the daily challenge of survival. But the fundamental gap between traditional and modern is perhaps wider in Africa than anywhere else in the world and may well be harder to bridge. What is the future of Africa? It seems almost foolhardy to seek an answer to such a question, given the degree of ethnic, linguistic, and cultural diversity that exists throughout the vast continent. Not surprisingly, visions of the future are equally diverse. Some Africans still yearn for the dreams embodied in the programs of the OOA. Novelist Ngiwa Thungo calls for an internationalization of all the democratic and social struggles for human equality, justice, peace, and progress. Others have discarded the democratic ideal and turned their attention to systems based on the subordination of the individual to the community as the guiding principle of national development. Like all peoples, Africans must ultimately find their own solutions within the context of their own traditions, not by seeking to imitate the example of others. Learning the ABCs in Niger. Educating the young is one of the most crucial problems for many African societies today. Few governments are able to allocate the funds necessary to meet the challenge, so religious organizations, Muslim or Christian, often take up the slack. In this photo, students at a madrasa, Muslim school designed to teach the Quran, are learning how to read Arabic, the language of Islam's holy scripture. Madrasas are one of the most prominent forms of schooling in Muslim societies in West Africa today. Salt of the earth. During the pre-colonial era, many West African societies were forced to import salt from Mediterranean countries in exchange for tropical products and gold. Today, the people of Senegal satisfy their domestic needs by mining salt deposits contained in lakes like this one in the interior of the country. These lakes are the remnants of vast seas that covered the region of the Sahara in prehistoric times. Note that women are doing much of the heavy labor while men hold the managerial positions. The idea of Muslim unity. We Muslims are of one family even though we live under different governments and in various regions. So said Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini, the Islamic religious figure and leader of the 1979 revolution that overthrew the Shah in Iran. The Ayatollah's remark was dismissed by some as just a pious wish by a religious mystic. In fact, however, it illustrates a crucial aspect of the political dynamics in the region. If the concept of cultural uniqueness represents an alternative to the system of nation-states in Africa, the desire for Muslim unity has played a similar role in the Middle East. In both regions, a yearning for a sense of community beyond national borders tugs at the emotions and intellect of their inhabitants. A dramatic example of the powerful force of pan-Islamic sentiment took place on September 11, 2001, when Muslim militants hijacked four U.S. airliners and turned them into missiles aimed at the center of world capitalism. The headquarters of the terrorist network that carried out the attack, known as Al-Qaeda and led by Osama bin Laden, was located in Afghanistan, but the militants themselves came from several different Muslim states. Although moderate Muslims throughout the world condemned the attack, it was clear that bin Laden and his cohorts had tapped into a wellspring of hostility and resentment directed at much of the Western world. What were the sources of Muslim anger? In a speech released on videotape shortly after the attack, bin Laden declared that the attacks were a response to the humiliation and disgrace that had afflicted the Islamic world for more than 80 years, a period dating back to the end of World War I. For the Middle East, the period between the two world wars was an era of transition. With the fall of the Ottoman and Persian empires, new modernizing regimes emerged in Turkey and Iran, and a more traditionalist but fiercely independent government was established in Saudi Arabia. Elsewhere, however, European influence was on the ascendant. The British and French had mandates in Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, and Palestine, and British influence persisted in Iraq, in southern Arabia, and throughout the Nile Valley. During World War II, the Middle East became the cockpit of European rivalries, as it had been during World War I. The region was more significant to the warring powers than previously because of the growing importance of oil and the Suez Canal's position as a vital sea route. The question of Palestine. The UN votes for two states, 1947. The end of World War II led to the emergence of a number of independent states in the Middle East. Jordan, Lebanon, and Syria, all European mandates before the war, became independent. Egypt, Iran, and Iraq, though still under a degree of Western influence, became increasingly autonomous. Sympathy for the idea of Arab unity led to the formation of the Arab League in 1945. But different points of view among its members prevented it from achieving anything of substance. The one issue on which all Muslim states in the area could agree was the question of Palestine. As tensions between Jews and Arabs in that mandate intensified during the 1930s, the British attempted to limit Jewish immigration into the area and firmly rejected proposals for independence, despite the promise made in the 1917 Balfour Declaration. After World War II ended, the situation drifted rapidly toward crisis, as thousands of Jewish refugees, many of them from displaced persons camps in Europe, sought to migrate to Palestine despite British efforts to prevent their arrival. As violence between Muslims and Jews intensified in the fall of 1947, the issue was taken up in the United Nations General Assembly. After an intense debate, the Assembly voted to approve the partition of Palestine into two separate states, one for the Jews and one for the Arabs. The city of Jerusalem was to be placed under international control. A UN commission was established to iron out the details and determine the future boundaries. Israel declares independence, 1948. David Ben-Gurion. During the next several months, growing hostility between Jewish and Arab forces, the latter increasingly supported by neighboring Muslim states, caused the British to announce that they would withdraw their own peacekeeping forces by May 15, 1948. Shortly after the stroke of midnight, as the British mandate formally came to a close, the Zionist leader David Ben-Gurion announced the independence of the State of Israel. First Arab-Israeli War. Later that same day, the new state was formally recognized by the United States, while military forces from several neighboring Muslim states, all of which had vigorously opposed the formation of a Jewish state in the region, entered Israeli territory but were beaten back. Thousands of Arab residents of the new state fled. Internal dissonance among the Arabs, combined with the strength of Jewish resistance groups, contributed to the failure of the invasion, but the bitterness between the two sides did not subside. The Muslim states refused to recognize the new State of Israel, which became a member of the United Nations, legitimizing it in the eyes of the rest of the world. The stage for future conflict was set. Flood of Palestinian refugees into Lebanon and Jordan. The exodus of thousands of Palestinian refugees into neighboring Muslim states had repercussions that are still felt today. Jordan, which had become an independent kingdom under its Hashemite ruler, was flooded by the arrival of 1 million urban Palestinians, overwhelming its own 500,000 people, most of whom were Bedouins. To the north, the state of Lebanon had been created to provide the local Christian community with a country of their own, but the arrival of the Palestinian refugees upset the delicate balance between Christians and Muslims. Moreover, the creation of Lebanon had angered the Syrians, who had lost that land as well as other territories to Turkey as a result of European decisions before and after the war. Nasser and Pan? Arabism. King Farouk of Egypt, 1936-1952. The dispute over Palestine placed Egypt in an uncomfortable position. Technically, Egypt was not an Arab state. King Farouk, who had acceded to power in 1936, had frequently declared support for the Arab cause, but the Egyptian people were not Bedouins and shared little of the culture of the peoples across the Red Sea. In 1952, King Farouk, whose corrupt habits had severely eroded his early popularity, was overthrown by a military coup engineered by the young military officers who abolished the monarchy and established a republic. Gamal Abdel Nasser, 1954-1970. In 1954, one of those officers, Colonel Gamal Abdel Nasser, seized power in his own right and immediately instituted a land reform program. He also adopted a policy of neutrality in foreign affairs and expressed sympathy for the Arab cause. The Suez Crisis, 1956. The British presence had rankled many Egyptians for years, for even after granting Egypt independence, Britain had retained control over the Suez Canal to protect its route to the Indian Ocean. In 1956, Nasser suddenly nationalized the Suez Canal Company, which had been under British and French administration. Seeing a threat to their route to the Indian Ocean, the British and the French launched a joint attack on Egypt to protect their investment. They were joined attack on Egypt to protect their investment. They were joined by Israel, whose leaders had grown exasperated at sporadic Arab commando raids on Israeli territory and now decided to strike back. But the Eisenhower administration in the United States, concerned that the attack smacked of a revival of colonialism, supported Nasser and brought about the withdrawal of foreign forces from Egypt and of Israeli troops from the Sinai Peninsula. The United Arab Republic. Unity with Syria, 1958-1961. Nasser now turned to Pan-Arabism. In 1958, Egypt united with Syria as the United Arab Republic. The union had been proposed by the Ba'ath Party, which advocated the unity of all Arab states in a new socialist society. Nasser was named president of the new state. Egypt and Syria hoped that the union would eventually include all Arab states, but other Arab leaders, including young King Hussein of Jordan and the kings of Iraq and Saudi Arabia, were suspicious. The latter two in particular feared Pan-Arabism on the reasonable assumption that they would be asked to share their vast oil revenues with the poorer states of the Middle East. Indeed, in Nasser's view, through Arab unity, this wealth could be used to improve the standard of living in the area. In the end, Nasser's plans brought an end to the Arab. When the government announced the nationalization of a large number of industries and utilities in 1961, a military coup overthrew the Ba'ath leaders in Damascus, and the new authorities declared that Syria would end its relationship with Egypt. Palestine Liberation Organization. Yasser Arafat and al-Fatah. The breakup of the AR did not end the dream of Pan-Arabism. During the mid-1960s, Egypt took the lead in promoting Arab unity against Israel. At a meeting of Arab leaders held in Jerusalem in 1964, the Palestine Liberation Organization, PLO, was set up under Egyptian sponsorship to represent the interests of the Palestinians. According to the charter of the PLO, only the Palestinian people, and thus not Jewish immigrants from abroad, had the right to form a state in the old British Mandate. A guerrilla movement called al-Fatah, led by the dissident PLO figure Yasser Arafat, began to launch terrorist attacks on Israeli territory. The Arab-Israeli dispute. Proportional representation. Growing Arab hostility was a constant threat to the security of Israel, whose leaders dedicated themselves to creating a Jewish homeland. The government attempted to build a democratic and modern state that would be a magnet for Jews throughout the world and a symbol of Jewish achievement. Ensuring the survival of the tiny state surrounded by antagonistic Arab neighbors was a considerable challenge, made more difficult by divisions within the Israeli population. Some were immigrants from Europe, while others came from other states in the Middle East. Some were secular and even socialist in their views, while others were politically and religiously conservative. The state was also home to Christians as well as Muslim Palestinians who had not fled to other countries. To balance these diverse interests, Israel established a parliament, called the Knesset, on the European model, with proportional representation based on the number of votes each party received in the general election. The parties were so numerous that none ever received a majority of votes, and all governments had to be formed from a coalition of several parties. As a result, moderate secular leaders such as longtime Prime Minister David Ben-Gurion had to cater to more marginal parties composed of conservative religious groups. The Six-Day War, 1967. In the spring of 1967, Nasser attempted to improve his standing in the Arab world by imposing a blockade against Israeli commerce through the Gulf of Aqaba. Concerned that it might be isolated, and lacking firm support from Western powers, which had originally guaranteed Israel the freedom to use the Gulf of Aqaba, in June 1967, Israel suddenly launched airstrikes against Egypt and several of its Arab neighbors. Israeli armies then broke the blockade at the head of the Gulf of Aqaba and occupied the Sinai Peninsula. Other Israeli forces attacked Jordanian territory on the west bank of the Jordan River. Jordan's King Hussein had recently signed an alliance with Egypt and placed his army under Egyptian command, occupied the whole of Jerusalem, and seized Syrian military positions in the Golan Heights, along the Israeli-Syrian border. Israel's brief Six-Day War had tripled the size of its territory but aroused even more bitter hostility among the Arabs. 1 million Palestinians were added inside its borders, most of them on the west bank of the Jordan River. Yom Kippur War, 1973. During the next few years, the focus of the Arab-Israeli dispute shifted as Arab states demanded the return of the territories lost in the 1967 war. Nasser died in 1970 and was succeeded by his vice president, ex-general Anwar al-Sadat. Sadat attempted to renew Arab unity through a new confrontation with Israel. In 1973, on Yom Kippur, the Jewish Day of Atonement, an Israeli national holiday, Egyptian forces suddenly launched an air and artillery attack on Israeli positions in East Sinai just east of the Suez Canal. Syrian armies attacked Israeli positions in the Golan Heights. After early Arab successes, the Israelis managed to recoup some of their losses on both fronts. As a superpower confrontation between the United States and the Soviet Union loomed, a ceasefire was finally reached. The Camp David Agreement, 1978. After his election as U.S. President in 1976, Jimmy Carter began to press for a compromise peace based on Israel's return of territories occupied during the 1967 war and Arab recognition of the State of Israel. In September 1978, Sadat and Israeli Prime Minister Menachem Begin met with Carter at Camp David, the presidential retreat in Maryland. In the first treaty signed with a Muslim state, Israel agreed to withdraw from the Sinai but not from other occupied territories unless other Muslim countries cognized Israel. The promise of the Camp David Agreement, however, was not fulfilled. One reason was the assassination of Sadat by Islamic militants in October 1981. But there were deeper causes, including the continued unwillingness of many Arab governments to recognize Israel and the Israeli government's encouragement of Jewish settlements on the occupied West Bank. The PLO and the Intifada. During the 1980s, the militancy of the Palestinians increased, leading to rising unrest, popularly labeled the Intifada, uprising, among PLO supporters living inside Israel. In response, U.S.-sponsored peace talks opened between Israel and a number of its neighbors, but progress was slow. Terrorist attacks by Palestinian militants resulted in heavy casualties and shook the confidence of many Jewish citizens that their security needs had been adequately protected. At the same time, Jewish residents of the West Bank resisted the extension of Palestinian authority in the area. In 1999, a new Labour government under Prime Minister Ehud Barak sought to revitalize the peace process. Negotiations resumed with the PLO and also got underway with Syria over a peace settlement in Lebanon and the possible return of the Golan Heights. But the talks broke down over the future of the city of Jerusalem, leading to massive riots by Palestinians and a dramatic increase in bloodshed on both sides. The death of Yasser Arafat in 2004 and his replacement by Palestinian moderate Mahmoud Abbas, as well as with the withdrawal of Israeli settlers from Gaza in 2005, raised modest hopes for progress in peace talks, but a year later, radical Muslim forces operating in southern Lebanon launched massive attacks on Israeli cities. In response, Israeli troops crossed the border in an effort to wipe out the source of the assault. 2 years later, militants in the Gaza Strip launched their own rocket attacks on sites in southern Israel. The latter responded forcefully, thereby raising the specter of a wider conflict. As attitudes hardened, national elections in early 2009 led to the return to office of former Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and a virtual stalemate in the peace process, revolution in Iran. Mohammad Reza Pahlavi, 1941-1979. In the late 1970s, another trouble spot arose in Iran, one of the key oil-exporting countries in the region. Under the leadership of Shah Mohammad Reza Pahlavi, who had taken over from his father in 1941, Iran had become one of the richest countries in the Middle East. During the 1950s and 1960s, Iran became a prime U.S. ally in the Middle East. With encouragement from the United States, which hoped that Iran could become a force for stability in the Persian Gulf, the Shah attempted to carry through a series of social and economic reforms to transform the country into the most advanced in the region. Per capita income increased dramatically, literacy rates improved, a modern communications infrastructure took shape, and an affluent middle class emerged in the capital of Tehran. Under the surface, however, trouble was brewing. Despite an ambitious land reform, many peasants were still landless, unemployment among intellectuals was dangerously high, and the urban middle class was squeezed by high inflation. Some of the unrest took the form of religious discontent as millions of devout Muslims looked with distaste at a new Iranian civilization based on greed, sexual license, and material accumulation. The fall of the Shah, 1979. Ayatollah Khomeini. Leading the opposition was Ayatollah Khomeini, an austere Shiite cleric who had been exiled to Iraq and then to France because of his outspoken opposition to the Shah's regime. From Paris, Khomeini continued his attacks in print, on television, and in radio broadcasts. By the late 1970s, large numbers of Iranians began to respond to Khomeini's diatribes against the satanic regime, and demonstrations by his supporters were repressed with ferocity by the police. But workers' strikes grew in intensity. In 1979, the government collapsed and was replaced by a hastily formed Islamic Republic. The new government, dominated by Shiite clergy under the guidance of Ayatollah Khomeini, immediately began to introduce traditional Islamic law. A new reign of terror ensued as supporters of the Shah were rounded up and executed. Though much of the outside world focused on the U.S. embassy in Tehran, where militants held a number of foreign hostages, the Iranian revolution involved much more. In the eyes of the Ayatollah and his followers, the United States was the great Satan, the powerful protector of Israel, and the enemy of Muslim peoples everywhere. Furthermore, it was responsible for the corruption of Iranian society under the Shah. With economic conditions in Iran rapidly deteriorating, the Islamic Revolutionary Government finally agreed to free the hostages in return for the release of Iranian assets in the United States. The revolution moderates. Mohammad Khatami. During the late 1990s, the intensity of the Iranian revolution moderated slightly as a new president, the moderate cleric Mohammad Khatami, displayed a modest tolerance for loosening clerical control over freedom of expression and social activities. But rising public criticism of rampant official corruption and a high rate of inflation sparked a new wave of government repression. Newspapers were censored, the universities were purged of disloyal or un-Islamic elements, and religious militants raided private homes in search of blasphemous activities. Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, since 2004. In 2004, presidential elections brought a new leader, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, to power in Tehran. He immediately inflamed the situation by calling publicly for the destruction of the State of Israel, while his government aroused unease throughout the world by indicating its determination to develop a nuclear energy program, ostensibly for peaceful purposes. Iran has also provided support for Hezbollah, a militant Shiite organization based in Lebanon, and other terrorist groups in the region. Despite worsening conditions at home that eroded the government's popularity, Ahmadinejad was re-elected in June 2009, although opponents claimed that numerous irregularities had occurred during the elections. Crisis in the Persian Gulf. Although much of the Iranians' anger was directed against the United States during the early phases of the revolution, Iran had equally hated enemies closer to home. To the north, the immense power of the Soviet Union, driven by atheistic communism, was viewed as a modern version of the Russian threat of previous centuries. To the west was a militant and hostile Iraq, now under the leadership of the ambitious Saddam Hussein. Iraq had just passed through a turbulent period. The monarchy had been overthrown by a military coup in 1958, but conflicts within the ruling military junta led to chronic instability, and in 1979 Colonel Saddam Hussein, a prominent member of the local Ba'athist party, seized power on his own. The vision of Saddam Hussein. Ba'athist Arab nationalism. Saddam Hussein was a fervent believer in the Ba'athist vision of a single Arab state in the Middle East and soon began to persecute non-Arab elements in Iraq, including Persians and Kurds. He then turned his sights to territorial expansion to the east. Iraq and Iran had long had an uneasy relationship, fueled by religious differences. Iranian Islam is predominantly Shiite, while the ruling caste in Iraq was Sunni, and a perennial dispute over borderlands adjacent to the Persian Gulf, the vital waterway for the export of oil from both countries. Like several of its neighbors, Iraq had long dreamed of unifying the Arabs but had been hindered by internal factions and suspicion among its neighbors. During the mid-1970s, Iran gave some support to a Kurdish rebellion in the mountains of Iraq. In 1975, the government of the Ha agreed to stop aiding the rebels in return for territorial concessions at the head of the Gulf. 5 years later, however, the Kurdish revolt had been suppressed. Iraq-Iran War, 1980-1988. Saddam Hussein now saw his opportunity, accusing Iran of violating the territorial agreement. He launched an attack on his neighbor in 1980. The war was a bloody one and lasted nearly 10 years. Poison gas was used against civilians, and children were employed to clear minefields. Finally, with both sides virtually exhausted, a ceasefire was arranged in the fall of 1988. Occupation of Kuwait, 1990. The bitter conflict with Iran had not slicked Saddam Hussein's appetite for territorial expansion. In early August 1990, Iraqi military forces suddenly moved across the border and occupied the small neighboring country of Kuwait at the head of the Gulf. The immediate pretext was the claim that Kuwait was pumping oil from fields inside Iraqi territory. Baghdad was also angry over the Kuwaiti government's demand for repayment of loans it had made to Iraq during the war with Iran. But the underlying reason was Iraq's contention that Kuwait was legally a part of Iraq. Kuwait had been part of the Ottoman Empire until the beginning of the 20th century, when the local prince had agreed to place his patrimony under British protection. When Iraq became independent in 1932, it claimed the area on the grounds that the state of Kuwait had been created by British imperialism, but opposition from major Western powers and other countries in the region, which feared the consequences of a greater Iraq, prevented an Iraqi takeover. Operation Desert Storm, 1991. The Iraqi invasion of Kuwait in 1990 sparked an international outcry, and the United States assembled a multinational coalition that, under the name Operation Desert Storm, liberated the country and destroyed a substantial part of Iraq's armed forces. President George H.W. Bush had promised the American people that U.S. troops would not fight with one hand tied behind their backs, a clear reference to the Vietnam War, but the Allied forces did not occupy Baghdad at the end of the war out of fear that doing so would cause a breakup of the country, an eventuality that would operate to the benefit of Iran. The Allies hoped instead that Saddam's regime would be ousted by an internal revolt. In the meantime, harsh economic sanctions were imposed on the Iraqi government as the condition for peace. The anticipated overthrow of Saddam Hussein did not materialize, however, and his tireless efforts to evade the conditions of the ceasefire continued to bedevil the next U.S. president, Bill Clinton, and his successor, George W. Bush. Conflicts in Afghanistan and Iraq. U.S. war against the Taliban in Afghanistan, since 2001. The terrorist attacks launched against U.S. cities in September 2001 added a new dimension to the Middle Eastern equation. After the failure of the Soviet Union to quell the rebellion in Afghanistan during the 1980s, a fundamentalist Muslim group known as the Taliban, supported covertly by the United States, seized power in Kabul and ruled the country with a fanaticism reminiscent of the Cultural Revolution in China. Backed by conservative religious forces in Pakistan, the Taliban provided a base of operations for Osama bin Laden's Al-Qaeda terrorist network. After the attacks of September 11, a coalition of forces led by the United States overthrew the Taliban and attempted to build a new and moderate government in Afghanistan. But the country's history of bitter internecine warfare among tribal groups presented a severe challenge to those efforts, and Taliban forces have managed to regroup and continue to operate in the mountainous region adjacent to the Pakistani border. The terrorist threat from Al-Qaeda, however, was dealt a major blow in May 2011, when Osama bin Laden was killed by U.S. Special Operations Force during a raid on his hideout in northern Pakistan. U.S. War in Iraq, 2003-2011. After moving against the Taliban at the end of 2001, the administration of George W. Bush, charging that Iraqi dictator Saddam Hussein had not only provided support to bin Laden's terrorist organization but also stockpiled weapons of mass destruction for use against his enemies, threatened to invade Iraq and remove him from power. It was the president's hope that the overthrow of the Iraqi dictator would promote the spread of democracy throughout the region. The plan, widely debated in the media and opposed by many of the United States' traditional allies, disquieted Arab leaders and fanned anti-American sentiment throughout the Muslim world. Nevertheless, in March 2003, U.S.-led forces attacked Iraq and overthrew Saddam Hussein's regime. In the months that followed, occupation forces sought to restore stability to the country while setting out plans on which to build a democratic society. But although Saddam Hussein was captured by U.S. troops and later executed, armed resistance by militant Muslim elements continued. When the Obama administration came into office in 2009, it focused its efforts on training an Iraqi military force capable of defeating the remaining insurgents. In the meantime, a fragile government has been formed in Baghdad, the embryo of a possible pro-Western state that could serve as an emblem of democracy in the Middle East. Squabbling among Sunni, Shiite, and Kurdish elements within the country, however, continued as the last U.S. combat troops were removed in the fall of 2011. Revolution in the Middle East, 2011. Revolts in Tunisia, Syria, and Yemen. In the early months of 2011, popular protests against current conditions broke out in several countries in the Middle East. Beginning in Tunisia, the riots spread rapidly to Egypt, where they brought about the abrupt resignation of longtime President Hosni Mubarak. Overthrow of Mubarak in Egypt. And then to other countries in the region, including Syria, Libya, and Yemen, where political leaders sought to quell the unrest, often by violent means. Overthrow of Gaddafi in Libya. In Libya, the brutal regime of dictator Muammar Gaddafi was overthrown by a popular revolt with the assistance of NATO airstrikes. The uprisings aroused hopes around the world that the seeds of democracy had been planted in a region long dominated by autocratic governments, but also provoked widespread concern that unstable conditions could lead to further violence and a rise in international terrorism. In the months following the outbreak of unrest, the prognosis for the future of the region was still unclear. Map 29.2 Israel and its neighbors. This map shows the evolution of the State of Israel since its founding in 1948. Areas occupied by Israel after the Six-Day War in 1967 are indicated in green. The Temple Mount at Jerusalem. The Temple Mount is one of the most sacred sites in the city of Jerusalem. Originally, it was the site of a temple built during the reign of Solomon, king of the Israelites. About 1000 BC, the western wall of the temple is shown in the foreground. Beyond the wall is the Dome of the Rock complex, built on the place from which Muslims believe that Muhammad ascended to heaven. Sacred to both religions, the Temple Mount is now a major bone of contention between Muslims and Jews and a prime obstacle to a final settlement of the Arab-Israeli dispute. Society and culture in the contemporary Middle East. In the Middle East today, all aspects of society and culture, from political and economic issues to literature, art, and the role of the family, are intertwined with questions of religious faith. Varieties of government, the politics of Islam. Feudal regimes, Saudi Arabia. To many seasoned observers, the strategy applied by President George W. Bush in Iraq appeared unrealistic, since democratic values are not deeply rooted in the culture of the Middle East. In many countries, feudal rulers remain securely in power. The kings of Saudi Arabia, for example, continue to govern by traditional precepts and, citing the distinctive character of Muslim society, have been reluctant to establish representative political institutions. Charismatic dictatorships. Nasser, Khomeini, Gaddafi. To be sure, there have been variations in government throughout the region. In some societies, traditional authority has been replaced by charismatic one-party rule or military dictatorships. Nasser's Egypt was a single-party state where the leader won political power by the force of his presence or personality. The regimes of Ayatollah Khomeini in Iraq could also trace much of their power to the personal appeal of the leader. Modernizing bureaucratic regimes. Sadat and Mubarak in Egypt. Other states have seen the emergence of modernizing bureaucratic regimes. Examples include the governments of Syria, Yemen, Turkey, and Egypt, where Anwar al-Sadat and his successor, Hosni Mubarak, focused on performance. Most of these regimes have remained highly autocratic in character, however, except in Turkey, where free elections and the sharing of power have become more prevalent in recent years. Democratic experiments. A few Arab nations, such as Bahrain, Kuwait, and Jordan, have engaged in limited forms of democratic experimentation. Most of the region's recent leaders, however, have maintained that Western-style democracy is not appropriate for their societies. Bashar al-Assad, the president of Syria, once remarked that he would tolerate only positive criticism of his policies. President Mubarak of Egypt often insisted to foreign critics that only authoritarian rule could prevent the spread of Islamic radicalism throughout his country. Most world leaders have accepted the logic of these contentions, provoking some critics' charge that Western governments coddle Middle Eastern dictatorships as a means of maintaining stability in the region and preserving their access to the vast oil reserves located on the Arabian Peninsula. The sudden outbreak of popular unrest that has erupted from North Africa to the Arabian Peninsula since the spring of 2011 raises questions about the potential for democratic changes to emerge in the countries throughout the region. Are democratic institutions and the principles of human freedom truly antithetical to the culture of the Middle East and the principles of Islam? As we await the consequences of the current wave of popular unrest, the fate of the region hangs in the balance. The economics of the Middle East, oil and sand. Economic disparities, oil or no oil. Few areas exhibit a greater disparity of individual and national wealth than the Middle East. While millions live in abject poverty, a fortunate few rank among the wealthiest people in the world. The primary reason for this disparity is oil. Unfortunately for most of the peoples of the region, oil reserves are distributed unevenly and all too often are located in areas where the population density is low. Egypt and Turkey, with more than 75 million inhabitants apiece, have almost no oil reserves. The combined population of oil-rich Kuwait, the United Arab Emirates, and Saudi Arabia is about 35 million people. This disparity in wealth inspired Nasser's quest for Arab unity but has also posed a major obstacle to that unity. Economics and Islam. Socialism or capitalism? Not surprisingly, considering their different resources and political systems, the states of the Middle East have adopted diverse approaches to the problem of developing strong and stable economies. Some, like Nasser in Egypt and the leaders of the Ba'ath Party in Syria, briefly attempted to create a form of Arab socialism, favoring a high level of government involvement in the economy to relieve the inequities of the free enterprise system. Others turned to the Western capitalist model to maximize growth while using taxes or massive development projects to build a modern infrastructure, redistribute wealth, and maintain political stability and economic opportunity for all. Rapid population growth, widespread corruption, and the absence of adequate educational and technological skills, however, have all acted as a drag on economic growth throughout the region. Unfortunately, the Quran provides little guidance to Muslims searching for the proper road to economic prosperity. Agricultural policies. Land reform. Although the amount of arable land is relatively small, most countries in the Middle East rely on farming to supply food for their growing populations. Much of the fertile land was once owned by wealthy absentee landlords, but land reform programs in several countries have attempted to alleviate this problem. The most comprehensive and probably the most successful land reform program was instituted in Egypt, where Nasser and his successors managed to reassign nearly a quarter of all cultivable lands by limiting the amount a single individual could hold. Similar programs in Iran, Iraq, Libya, and Syria generally had less effect. After the 1979 revolution in Iran, many farmers forcibly seized lands from the landlords, raising questions of ownership that the revolutionary government has tried to resolve with only minimal success. Lack of water. Agricultural productivity throughout the region has been plagued by a lack of water. With populations growing at more than 2% annually on average in the Middle East, several governments have tried to increase the amount of water available for irrigation. Many attempts have been sabotaged by government ineptitude, political disagreements, and territorial conflicts, however. For example, disputes between Israel and its neighbors over water rights and between Iraq and its neighbors over the exploitation of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers have caused serious tensions in recent years. Today, the dearth of water in the region is reaching crisis proportions. The Islamic revival. In recent years, developments in the Middle East have often been described in terms of a resurgence of traditional values and customs in response to Western influence. Modernist Islam. Ataturk in Turkey. Initially, many Muslim intellectuals responded to Western influence by trying to create a modernized set of Islamic beliefs and practices that would not clash with the demands of the 20th century. This process took place to some degree in most Islamic societies, but it was especially prevalent in Turkey, Egypt, and Iran. Mustafa Kemal Ataturk embraced the strategy when he attempted to secularize the Islamic religion in the new Turkish Republic. The Shahs in Iran, Nasser in Egypt. The Turkish model was followed by Shah Reza Khan and his son Muhammad Reza Pahlavi in Iran and then by Nasser in post-war Egypt, all of whom attempted to honor Islamic values while asserting the primacy of other issues such as political and economic development. Religion, in effect, had become the handmaiden of political power, national identity, and economic prosperity. These secularizing trends were particularly noticeable among the political, intellectual, and economic elites in urban areas. They had less influence in the countryside, among the poor, and among devout elements within the clergy. Many of the clerics believed that Western influence in the cities had given birth to political and economic corruption, sexual promiscuity, hedonism, individualism, and the prevalence of alcohol, pornography, and drugs. Although such practices had long existed in the Middle East, they were now far more visible and socially acceptable. Return to tradition. The Ayatollahs in Iran. Reaction among conservatives against the modernist movement was quick to emerge in several countries and reached its zenith in the late 1970s with the return of the Ayatollah Khomeini to Iran. It is not surprising that Iran took the lead in light of its long tradition of ideological purity within the Shiite sect as well as the uncompromisingly secular character of the Shah's reforms in the post-war era. In Iran today, traditional Islamic beliefs are all-pervasive and extend into education, clothing styles, social practices, and the legal system. In recent years, for example, Iranian women have been heavily fined or even flogged for violating the Islamic dress code. The cultural and social effects of the Iranian Revolution soon began to spread. In Algeria, the political influence of fundamentalist Islamic groups enabled them to win a stunning victory in the national elections in 1992. When the military stepped in to cancel the second round of elections and crack down on the militants, the latter responded with a campaign of terrorism against moderates that claimed thousands of lives. The Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. A similar trend emerged in Egypt, where militant groups such as the Muslim Brotherhood, formed in 1928 as a means of promoting personal piety, engaged in terrorism, including the assassination of President Anwar al-Sadat and attacks on foreign tourists, who are considered carriers of corrupt Western influence. In recent years, the Brotherhood has adopted a more moderate public stance and received broad support in elections held after the overthrow of the Mubarak regime. The AK Party in Turkey. Even in Turkey, generally considered the most secular of Islamic societies, a Muslim political group took power in a coalition government formed in 1996. The new government adopted a pro-Arab stance in foreign affairs and threatened to reduce the country's economic and political ties to Europe. Worried moderates voiced their concern that the secular legacy of Kemal Atatürk was being eroded, and eventually the government resigned under heavy pressure from the military. But a new Islamist organization, known as the Justice and Development Party, won elections held in 2007 and has signaled its intention to guarantee the rights of devout Muslims to display their faith publicly. In elections held in June 2001, the AK Party won a clear victory with about 50% of the vote. Throughout the Middle East, even individuals who do not support efforts to return to pure Islamic principles have adjusted their behavior and beliefs in subtle ways. In Egypt, for example, the authorities encouraged television programs devoted to religion in preference to comedies and adventure shows imported from the West, and alcohol is discouraged or at least consumed more discreetly. Women in the Middle East. Rights in modernist regimes and Israel. Nowhere have the fault lines between tradition and modernity in Muslim societies in the Middle East been so sharp as in the ongoing debate over the role of women. At the beginning of the 20th century, women's place in Middle Eastern society had changed little since the death of the Prophet Muhammad. Women were secluded in their homes and had few legal, political, or social rights. During the first decades of the 20th century, advocates of modernist views began to contend that Islamic doctrine was not inherently opposed to women's rights. To modernists, Islamic traditions such as female seclusion, wearing the veil, and polygamy were actually pre-Islamic folk traditions that had been tolerated in the early Islamic era and continued to be practiced in later centuries. Such views had a considerable impact on a number of Middle Eastern societies, including Turkey and Iran. As we have seen, greater rights for women were a crucial element in the social revolution promoted by Kemal Atatürk in Turkey. In Iran, Shah Reza Khan and his son granted female suffrage and encouraged the education of women. In Egypt, a vocal feminist movement arose in educated women's circles in Cairo as early as the 1920s. The same is true in Israel, where, except in Orthodox religious communities, women have achieved substantial equality with men and are active in politics, the professions, and even the armed forces. Golda Meir, Prime Minister of Israel from 1969 to 1974, became an international symbol of the ability of women to be world leaders. Traditional views in Iran, Saudi Arabia. In recent years, a more traditional view of women's role has tended to prevail in many Middle Eastern countries. Attacks by religious conservatives on the growing role of women contributed to the emotions underlying the Iranian Revolution of 1979. Iranian women were instructed to wear the veil and to dress modestly in public. The most conservative nation by far remains Saudi Arabia, where following Wahhabi tradition, women are not only segregated and expected to wear the veil in public but also restricted in education and forbidden to drive automobiles. Still, women's rights have been extended in a few countries. In 1999, women obtained the right to vote in Kuwait, and they have been granted an equal right with their husbands to seek a divorce in Egypt. Even in Iran, women have many freedoms that they lacked before the 20th century. For example, they can receive military training, vote, practice birth control, and publish fiction. Most important, today nearly 60% of university entrants in Iran are women. Literature and art. As in other areas of Asia and Africa, the encounter with the West in the 19th and 20th centuries stimulated a cultural renaissance in the Middle East. Muslim authors translated Western works into Arabic and Persian and began to experiment with new literary forms. Literature. Iran has produced one of the most prominent national literatures in the contemporary Middle East. Since World War II, Iranian literature has been hampered somewhat by political considerations, since it has been expected to serve first the Pahlavi monarchy and then the Islamic Republic. Nevertheless, Iranian writers are among the most prolific in the region and often write in prose, which has finally been accepted as the equal of poetry. Feminist critiques of the chador. Despite the male-oriented character of Iranian society, many of the new writers have been women. Since the revolution, the veil and the chador, an all-enveloping cloak, have become the central metaphor in Iranian women's writing. Those who favor the veil and chador praise them as the last bastion of defense against Western cultural imperialism. Behind the veil, the Islamic woman can breathe freely, unpopulated by foreign exploitation and moral corruption. Other Iranian women, however, consider the chador a mobile prison or an oppressive anachronism from the Dark Ages. As one writer, Suznazadi, expressed it, "As I pulled the chador over me, I felt a heaviness descending over me. I was hidden and in hiding. There was nothing visible left of Suznazadi." Whether or not they accept the veil and chador, women writers are a vital part of contemporary Iranian literature and are addressing all aspects of social issues. Naghib Mahfouz, Cairo Trilogy. Like Iran, Egypt in the 20th century experienced a flowering of literature accelerated by the establishment of the Egyptian Republic in the early 1950s. The most illustrious contemporary Egyptian writer was Naghib Mahfouz, who won the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1988. His Cairo Trilogy chronicles three generations of a merchant family in Cairo during the tumultuous years between the world wars. Mahfouz was particularly adept at blending panoramic historical events with the intimate lives of ordinary human beings. Unlike many other modern writers, his message was essentially optimistic and reflected his hope that religion and science can work together for the overall betterment of humankind. Art. Like literature, the art of the modern Middle East has been profoundly influenced by its exposure to Western culture. At first, artists tended to imitate Western models, but later they began to experiment with national styles, returning to earlier forms for inspiration. Some emulated the writers in returning to the village to depict peasants and shepherds, but others followed international trends and attempted to express the alienation and disillusionment that characterize so much of modern life. Wealth and poverty in the Middle East. Although many of the countries in the Middle East are relatively poor by world standards, A favored few have amassed great wealth as a result of their fortunate geographic location. Such is the case with the United Arab Emirates, a small country situated strategically on the eastern edge of the Arabian Peninsula and located directly over some of the most abundant oil reserves in the world. The modern city of Dubai, top photo, resplendent in its opulence, serves today as a playground for the rich and a vivid symbol of the wealth that has flowed into the region because of the world's thirst for energy. At the opposite extreme is Yemen, on the southern edge of the Arabian Peninsula. Lacking valuable resources, the people of Yemen live by traditional pursuits, as shown in the photo at the bottom.